Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is Westwind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. I'm happy to be joined today by Dr. Ross Camidge, who is a professor in the Division of Medical Oncology and the Joyce Zeff Chair in Lung Cancer Research, as well as the Director of Thoracic Oncology at the University of Colorado in Denver. Thanks for joining me, Ross.
It's my pleasure.
So let's start with the trajectory of your career.
So I was an undergraduate at Oxford, then I did a PhD in Cambridge in molecular biology, and then I went back to Oxford to complete medical studies.
So it isn't that you have to make an oath of loyalty to one or the other? You can actually do that?
Well, you know, obviously this is frowned upon, and that when they have the Oxford and Cambridge boat race, I have that sort of schizophrenic moment, yeah.
So you then worked as a pharmacologist at AstraZeneca for several years, is that correct?
So I double trained in medical oncology and clinical pharmacology. So part of the training in clinical pharmacology is often an industry attachment. And I was the test pilot for the first time they'd ever combined it with oncology. So I had this attachment to AstraZeneca to their oncology department where I was an experimental medicine physician for a year and a half. I was employed by Edinburgh University. I was on attachment to AstraZeneca, so I was the lowest paid person at AstraZeneca because I wasn't paid by them at all. But the great thing was they allowed me to essentially function in the role of somebody working in the pharmaceutical industry, so I got to see it all from the other side.
That's really interesting. Now, did you also train at all in radiation oncology? Because my understanding of medical oncology training in the UK is that you actually kind of cross-train and do some in both realms.
When I first started as a specialist trainee, I actually started in what's called clinical oncology, which you're right, is actually what in the USA would be called a radiation oncologist, although you can give chemo. And that's because I didn't know the difference. I just went, oh, it's an oncology job. And I realized it was very radiation heavy and I enjoyed it, but I realized that my passions lay elsewhere. And so after, again, about 18 months in that, I transitioned to this medical oncology, clinical pharmacology post.
Has your work in that setting given you any particular insight or training that you think other people who are in academic oncology, in the US at least, don't have?
So certainly it allows me to have sort of conversational radiation oncology skills. So I can understand radiation oncologists. And I think that certainly helped me when nearly a decade or so ago, we started doing this kind of, you know, radical approach, even in metastatic disease for oligoprogressive disease. And I'm sure my past experience in radiation oncology helped with that.
You came to the University of Colorado as a visiting professor in 2005. What led to the decision to leave the UK and the training you'd done there and come to the US in general, to Colorado in particular?
So it was coming to the end of my combined fellowship, the one in clinical pharmacology and medical oncology. And, you know, kind of you look at the people around you for sort of peers to sort of say, "That's I want to be like just like that guy or just like that woman there." And I didn't see them. And I realized that I needed to go somewhere else. And so I had some interaction with the American physicians, at least during my time at AstraZeneca. And I felt I really wanted to go to America in order to sort of spread my wings. And it was fortunate because I had an award from actually one of my alma maters from Cambridge University that would pay my salary for 2 years. So, of course, everyone offers you a job if you're a free employee for 2 years. And I got jobs up and down the East Coast and in Texas and various other ones. But I settled on Colorado because they were very good at drug development and they were very good at lung cancer, which was the two things I was interested in. And also they had, I guess, what they would like to think of as a sort of pioneer spirit, which is they often had no idea how to do some of the things I was interested in doing, but they didn't say, "We don't do it like that." We just said, "Okay, let's find out." And that allowed me to come in at the ground floor and then build things in the direction that I wanted to go.
That's really interesting. And now, when we reflect on the time since you started, at least at Colorado, the field of lung cancer has changed to one now guided by molecular marker testing and moving from a monolithic division between small cell and non-small cell, eventually to
histology, distinctions of squamous and non-squamous, and now increasingly narrower populations based on the presence or absence of more specific biomarkers. And in fact, your leading focus, at least over the last few years, has been on molecular testing and treating quite narrow populations, starting with ALK and more now to MET and some other uncommon to rare targets. Is this just a historical accident, or is there, is there something uniquely appealing or perhaps available at Colorado that makes this a very strong line of research for you?
So I think much of what we all do in our lives are historical accidents, but specifically here, I think I was helped by the time at AstraZeneca because I was there just when gefitinib was licensed, and I kind of drank the Kool-Aid that with the EGFR mutations weren't going to be the one and only exception, and everything else was going to be the same, that there were going to be subsequent examples. And so we actually started routine molecular testing, at least for EGFR and KRAS, in 2008, which was before anything was FDA licensed. And I was obviously helped by that by having, great colleagues. So Dara Eisner, who is a wonderful molecular pathologist, and Wilbur Franklin before her, who helped us to expand out our molecular testing panel. And then, other great colleagues like Bob Doble, who could do stuff in the lab and really kind of drill down to it. I mean, we're not a center that is so huge that I can specialize in cancer of the left lower lobe. We have to be able to be somewhat pluripotential. And I think one of the key things, just as you've done with Grace, is to be able to sort of look at the future and see where things are going and try and get in at the ground floor. And so we thought that molecular profiling, getting the right drug to the right patients, looking at mechanisms of acquired resistance, and constantly pushing the envelope was the way to go forward. We're also helped in Colorado, or helped or hindered, by the fact that we have a lot of never smokers with lung cancer. And also because of where we're geographically located, it's very easy to get to us. And so patients would come from all over the country and sometimes around the world to us, particularly if we had a drug that no one else had.
Yeah. And in fact, we wrote an article together, an editorial, Have Mutation Will Travel, about that kind of nascent experience of people getting on a plane and traveling sometimes quite great distances. In this case, for crizotinib, as ALK was initially being identified, and how that really changed the value proposition of research to, it was no longer just doing a trial looking for standard chemo plus or minus drug X in an unselected population and looking for an 8-week survival difference. I mean, this was one where the people who benefited could sometimes have remarkable benefits. And I think it's only increased that since then. I'm sure many of the people who you're treating in this molecularly selected way are increasingly having big payoffs.
I think so. I mean, I think I'd like for those listening at home that Jack West was the person who came up with the title, Have Mutation Will Travel. It was brilliant. It remains brilliant. And the idea that, people would often say, shall I travel for a clinical trial? And you go, well, more often than not, it's not going to work. And then that turned on its head because you weren't giving, one random drug to people. You were saying, I'm going to do a test. Now your chance of benefit is 70%. That's worth getting on a plane for. I think the other knock-on consequences were the pharmaceutical industry realized that you couldn't just place all clinical trials in, Connecticut and New York and, Boston, and you had to spread them around the country and around the world. And I think, that contributed to the egalitarianization, if that's a word, of clinical trials.
What about the challenge that, of course, to do these studies on molecularly selected populations, and at this point, EGFR and ALK are hopefully routine in rank and file practice, but ROS is a 1% population, and others that we look at, RET and MET and TREK and others, are not as routine and uncommon, and they're really predicated on doing NGS testing, a pretty broad panel most of the time. It's not going to be people doing 9 sequential individual tests. Is that something that you think is going to become routine enough that we are going to capture these patients, or are there going to be a lot of patients just getting PD-L1 tested, started on chemoimmunotherapy or immunotherapy alone, and they have a latent, undiscovered driver mutation that you never know about?
So I think we've had, you know, two steps forward and one step back with immunotherapy. So it's become so easy to give chemo immunotherapy to almost everybody, such that people aren't necessarily even doing PD-L1 testing now. But those patients who are not cured, and that's arguably 100% of people, will still need something later. And I think routine molecular testing remains key to the treatment of lung cancer. We did health economic modeling a few years ago, and essentially once you get past four analytes, you know, EGFR, ROS, BRAF, ALK, the cost becomes cheaper when you do a sequencing panel as opposed to just individual analytes. So we are at the tipping point now because we have five FDA-approved molecularly targeted abnormalities, the four I just described, plus NTRK gene rearrangements. I think we'll get a little bit of finessing. So one of the things that we've done in the last few years is recognizing that an RNA-based extraction prior to the NGS gives you more information, particularly on gene fusions and MET-exon 14 skip mutations, than a DNA-based extraction. It's a little insidious because if you do the standard NGS panel, you'll find the occasional gene rearrangement, you'll find the occasional MET-exon 14 skip mutation, and you'll go, look, our panel works. What you don't know is how many you're missing. And for example, with MET-exon 14, we doubled our detection rate when we added in the RNA extraction. So we're going to finesse that a little bit. We absolutely are going to need molecular testing going forward, regardless of immunotherapy. But I think the future is going to be about finding drivers for cancer, which are not point mutations and not gene rearrangements. And that is a whole nother area that the next 5 years will lead us into.
I'm also concerned that it is nuanced enough and takes so much understanding and finesse. I mean, as you mentioned, you have a phenomenal molecular pathology group. You have Dara Eisner and other talented people, and you have always been at the forefront. But meanwhile, we're seeing that there's just not enough even basic testing in the broader community. And you know, my concern is that the bottleneck is not going to be the knowledge of the best treatments, but the application of the basic best that should be available beyond the centers that eat, sleep, live, and breathe this.
I mean, you're right. I mean, you know, I do a lot of second opinions. They used to be in person. Now I do a lot of remote second opinions. And you know, you get people, and they would say, "Oh, they did the molecular testing. There is nothing there." And then when you look at the report, you go, "Well, this report is inadequate. You know, there either wasn't enough tissue or the testing itself has got great big holes in what it actually detects." But, you know, we have to educate medical oncologists to, you know, just like medical oncologists have some exposure to radiation oncology, I had rather a lot, but most get some, they need that molecular pathology education going forward. So maybe it's going to take a generation. I don't know. But we desperately need to educate the medical oncologists to interpret the tests accurately.
And I think that's a real concern, and that's one that I've articulated about NGS even potentially having harm, because I get questions about people who have a KRAS mutation and there's a specific treatment pursued based on preclinical evidence that's cited in a foundation report or something, and at the same time, BRAF, maybe you'll have a non-V600E mutation and people are thinking, well, just try tabrafenib and trametinib for this. And I think if you go off that established path, there's a real potential to do harm by bypassing the better established treatments in favor of something that's more speculative, whether people realize that or not.
Yeah, it's like the other side of the coin. So one side is, you know, what are you missing? And the other is, what are you massively overinterpreting?
Yeah, absolutely. So, and I just think we need to get that level of insight that you can provide in your second opinions, or I think we're just going to need to have that come from the NCCN guidelines and from potentially a Watson for Oncology, if that actually functioned, you know, or other ways to disseminate the level of expertise that you and Dara Eisner and several centers of excellence have, but on a more broad scale.
One of the things that, you know, we talked about is, you know, you encounter a drug company and they go, look, I've developed this drug for this incredibly rare thing. You know, how should I develop my marketing campaign for, you know, gene rearrangement X? And you go, well, don't. get together with everyone else who has gene rearrangements X, Y, Z, and then just do a general awareness campaign. So I think there could be a tide that floats all boats, fueled by pharma dollars, you know, when we have these licensed treatments. And this kind of like, you know, trying to get a busy community oncologist to come to an educational day about something that they'll see once every 5 years is ridiculous. We have to, again, just like the economy of moving from single analytes to a panel, we have to move education away from single analytes to a panel-based, you know, education.
What is the platform that you do for many of your distant second opinions? Is it actual video based, or is it reviewing records, or is it something through formally through the University of Colorado or an outside source?
So it's done through the University of Colorado. So it's really simple. So, you know, you schedule an appointment just as you would normally. The scheduler gets your records, gets your scans on CD-ROM, gets them all loaded on the system. We have the Epic electronic medical record, and you're scheduled on, you know, at a particular time. The only difference is you're not in the room and I speak to you on the phone. You see, I'm not as good looking as you, so I don't do it over video. Just do it over the phone.
Right. Well, I was thinking of naming this podcast Face for Radio, but whatever. So. Well, I'm glad it works, and I definitely think it's a great boon to be able to share that insight to people who may not have an easy way to get to you. And I know that Denver is relatively central, but there's a lot of people who cannot easily travel even an hour or two away. And if you can get that insight without having to travel for it, I think that's terrific.
Well, so Jack, I think you're concerned with these things, and I think you're right, is these remote second opinions in some places, you know, the worst example is you send all your notes in and you get a letter back and you don't speak to anyone. And a lot of that letter is just cut and paste. Or if you do speak to someone, it's the guy who, you know, with all due respect, is probably relatively low on the totem pole because they have the time to do it. But the patients seeking these are very sophisticated patients. They don't want the basics on how to manage lung cancer. They've already been through that. They're saying, look, I'm on my fifth line therapy and I need to interpret this molecular test, and where's the clinical trial? I live in Singapore or wherever. And so we very much stack our remote second opinions with the senior doctors doing them.
And in fact, I am a believer, and I'm now at City of Hope, where we're working largely on delivering expertise in a distant way through a few different formats, largely review of records and case review, and discuss the outgoing report with the local physicians. There are a lot of ways to execute this, but I think it is the future, and there are many potential platforms for doing it. So I think it's great. I just think we need to narrow the gap between the narrower subspecialists and those who are seeing and treating 10 or 12 or 15 different kinds of cancer a day, because I don't think you can keep up with the extreme nuances of lung cancer as the standards of care change every few months now, which is a great problem to have.
Yeah, I mean, I always end my remote second opinion letters with a line that says, show this to your treating physician. So the second opinions are not done behind someone's back. They're about bringing everyone into the team and having everyone communicate together.
Very good. Getting even more granular, you've focused on the activity in the central nervous system for targeted therapies. And this is a relatively new area. It seems, because we previously didn't have tools that could meaningfully address that variable. Can you talk about what it's been like to cultivate essentially a new field, a new metric, and develop new endpoints that have only become relevant now that we have agents that can potentially differentiate themselves in that arena?
So I think the ALK field has had a number of knock-on effects separate in and of the benefit just to ALK. And one of them is definitely realizing that the brain is this relevant battleground that we have to address head on. It became clear that crizotinib had this overt liability in the sense it was great at controlling ALK-positive disease in the body, but didn't really get into the brain. And we saw that because a lot of patients, when they first progressed, were progressing in the brain, and that was the only site of progression. And that was the first light bulb moment that maybe this was pharmacological failure of delivery of the drug. And then as we start to get these next generation drugs coming through, you would see something relatively amusing going on, which we still see in sometimes presentations, which is people will show one MRI of a patient with a lesion getting smaller and they conclude our drug has CNS activity. And you go, well, that's like showing one chest x-ray and saying, look, it got smaller. Our drug has activity against lung cancer in the chest. And you go, well, that's silly. How you know, why have we forgotten all of the robustness that we've learned in the last few years? Why don't we apply that to the brain? And I was fortunate that somehow, I can't quite remember how it happened. I think I'd written an editorial or something, and I got approached by this group called RANO, Response Assessment in Neuro-Oncology, who had developed guidelines for primary brain tumors and were just starting to say, look, let's look at secondary brain tumors, brain metastases. And it was headed by a neuro-oncologist at the Harvard group and then some breast cancer physicians. And I ended up the only thoracic oncologist on it. And again, it's just kind of luck that I was able to contribute the data that we're seeing in EGFR and ALK in terms of like silly mistakes that we've made in terms of, you know, presenting data as if it was activity in the brain when really it was perhaps not so. And also that led, at least in January 2018, to me being able to be the first author on some guidelines. I said, look, everything that we've learned, this is actually ideally how we would do it better going forward. And it actually has a template for how you would design studies going forward to capture disease in the brain. I mean, I do feel occasionally a bit like Cassandra, where I'm standing up there and people are going, no, you're an idiot. You don't know what you're talking about. But gradually, I feel that we're gaining traction. And I think in the future, we hope that people will present not just an overall response or progression-free survival, which is conceivably contributed by both CNS and extra-CNS disease, but formally present CNS efficacy and extra-CNS efficacy, because we are seeing this disconnect.
Well, I think that it's just going to take time to come from not really presenting this as a relevant endpoint to accepting it and now making it a more routine or normalized part of what you ask about, at least the targeted therapies, but increasingly about others. And I think that one very practical and practice-changing effect that started with the ALK inhibitors, or at least the second-generation ALK inhibitors, was that we now routinely favor starting with a systemic targeted therapy or potentially immunotherapy in patients who have smaller, typically asymptomatic brain metastases, rather than go reflexively to radiation oncology to address it, because we are much more hopeful, rightfully so, that patients on alectinib, brigatinib, osimertinib, and potentially immunotherapy can have a very good and sustained CNS response.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're definitely there for the targeted therapies that you've quoted, where we're getting CNS response rates of 60, 70, 80%. Immunotherapy, the response rates are looking about the same as in the body, which is 20 to 30% in an unselected population.
And right.
I don't know that I would reach for that before radiotherapy if I was just using immunotherapy. I think that's a bit more debatable.
Well, there's definitely not as much data on it. I think the question is really just, yes, if this is an unselected population, or can you weigh that if you knew that a patient had very high PD-L1 and or tumor mutation burden? Would you be more hopeful? I agree with you. I just think that the targeted therapies have given us this at least proof of principle that if you have an enriched population that can have a very dramatic response, you may be able to obviate the need for local therapy in the brain at least for a while.
Yeah, I mean, I really think, you know, we talked about communication. You know, when you get the patient who has even, I think, symptomatic brain metastases, if they have a driver oncogene, if you can put them on a TKI and they respond, you are duty bound to bring that patient back to the neurosurgeons and the radiation oncologists and say, look, guys, this guy didn't just fall off a cliff because you didn't find out what happened to him. This is what happened.
Absolutely. We'll continue the discussion with Dr. Ross Camidge in the next episode.
Thanks so much for joining me today for this Westwind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com or looking for Westwind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.